Good morning, folks. Thank you for joining us today. Just reading in the chat there and was reminded that Melbourne has gone into another 6-week lockdown due to COVID. I think if a few people probably saw that one coming in the last couple of days, at least I've been talking to people over there who felt it was definitely going to happen. So sorry to you guys, and hopefully the rest of us aren't soon in similar boats, but I think it's quite possible we will be. On a much happier note, welcome to this morning's webinar, which is with Tom Wilkinson from Organise Chaos. So we're going to look at event site management, which is one of those, I think one of those areas that a lot of us in the industry probably recognize and understand the importance of. In my experience, a lot of people outside of the industry don't maybe realize the importance of or even know what happens. I think much like a lot of the roles in our industry, unless you're involved, some people don't really think of what's involved in putting things together. And I know event site management, especially on complex or larger events, the function is significant and important. And we have a couple of guys on our team, Desi, who's very, very good at that as a role, and generally fills it for us. My business partner, Martin, would do it a lot as well. And it is a specific skill set. I think people who are good at it come up with their own systems, come up with ways to do it, ways that work for them. It's one of those areas that people do differently. They get to the same end result, but you know they have different routes to get there. So I think it's always fascinating to listen to an experienced person who takes that on as a role. So I'm delighted that Tom is going to do this for us. I've seen the presentation; it's very good. So I'm looking forward to it. Very quick, the usual housekeeping, use the chat to ask questions. We'll keep an eye on what's going on in there. And Tom's quite happy for us to jump in. If things come up that we want to address before moving on, we'll naturally do the Q&A at the end like we usually do. So you can hold on to then if you want. But if you put the questions in as you think of them, it may make sense for us to jump in and deal with them. As usual, thanks to Actavo Events for working with us on these and supporting us for running them. We're coming under increasing pressure to do more of these and to add to the schedule because we've got a lot of people interested in delivering. So might have a bit of news on that in the next week or so. But again, Actavo have been great. Paul Griffin and the team, very keen to help and stay involved. I've spoken to Tom as well. And I think what we'll do with the Q&A, as usual, we'll put that raise your hand to speak functionality live. So if you're interested in turning your mic on or even turning your mic and your camera on and coming on and asking a question, we always like that because it makes things a bit more interactive. So the clever among you may want to do that if you definitely want your question answered, because we'll probably bring you on and we like that level of interaction. So other than that, the usual, talk to us in the chat. Let us know what's going on. Let us know what you want us to ask Tom or hope he covers, and we'll address it if we can along the way. I think Tom has popped in there and is ready to go. So I'm going to let him take over. And I'll talk to you guys in a little while. Enjoy it.
Cool. Thanks very much for that. As Mike said, I'm Tom Wilkinson. We'll get these slides up now and we'll start moving with it. So 2 seconds. Where are we? Mark, I've not had the big green button pop up for me to be able to get this show on the road.
All right, no wonder. Give me 1 second and I should be able to sort that for you. In the meantime, feel free to tell people all about yourself there, and I'll pop these slides up once I have them sorted for you.
Gabbing on, thank you very much. So as Mark said, my name is Tom Wilkinson. I am a director for Organise Chaos. We specialize in live events, which is mainly music festivals, but that also covers to an extent some TV bits and pieces, some corporate work, and also a bit of safety. I head up the site management side of the business, and my partner Claire heads up the sort of operational and safety side of things here. Started when I was about 18. I was very lucky to be part of the site crew for Dicty down at Glastonbury. So that was on the pyramid in the other stage. Hey, there we go, look at that. So that was my starting off in the business. And I was lucky there to work under the likes of Dave Wilkie, John Clark, and some other really good site managers, which definitely sort of set me on a good footing. Moving on from there, I went and did lots of other sort of crewing work, and then went on to work for Eve Trackway, as they were. I think they're now Sunbelt Rentals, but that was a season with them. Lots of barriers and trackways, you can imagine. And from there, I then went on to work for GMC Events based in Bristol. And under the watchful eye of Graham McVoy, I started doing some site management stuff. Started off as all sorts of smaller bits and pieces. And then as my experience grew, ended up doing wonderful things like Love Saves a Day, the Arcadia shows in Queen's Square, Standing Calling, and some other bits and pieces. Alongside that, did some bits and pieces for Glastonbury, where I was lucky enough to sort of manage their West Holt stage for them. So that's a little bit about me. I'm actually going to skip back for a second because we've got a poll for you guys. It'd be great to know what your background is, you know, where you're from, sort of which options you've got. As ever, there's the other option. If you fancy it, stick that other in the chat. Let us know what that other is. It's always nice to know who's on these webinars. And hopefully I'll be able to tailor some things towards your experience and your events work there. Try and bring it in, make it relevant to you guys. So I can see it popping up.
Yeah, it's quite interesting, actually. I don't think we've had as strong a representation from sporting events before, which is good. It's hovering at 20% there. The only one higher, really, well, other is a little bit higher, and then Greenfield Events at about 25, but I think sporting is coming into its own lately, or maybe they're all just very keen on CPG. I don't know.
I'm not sure. No, it's nice to see a good split of everyone. Sort of, you know, it's nice to know there's a wide audience out there. We'll start moving into it. Thanks very much for letting us know who you are and what you're up to out there. As I say, that was a bit about me, but I've bored you with that already. So we'll move on to what is site management. I'd never really tried to define it. I guess like most people, you're kind of a bit too busy to work out exactly what the definition of your job is. So I haven't, but then I decided Google, as ever, would probably have a fairly good answer. And that's the answer that it threw up to me. Not bad. I would say that a lot more of what I do isn't just on site, or what site managers do, I should say, isn't just on site. There's a lot of advanced work, as with most event planning stuff. So that's there. Again, sort of before we jump into the sort of ins and outs of actual site management works, it's probably just good to sort of have a little look at exactly what site management involves and sort of note that it's got quite a wide scope, I think, that can vary depending on who you're working for and exactly what the job is. It's obviously very important to establish that early on when you're taking on the role. So that's kind of obviously as you're getting booked, what you're looking for. Changes around that might evolve. Certainly on bigger shows, you might end up just looking after a specific area of that site. So whilst you are the site manager, you might not be the overall site manager. Different folks, different strokes with how they advance their shows. Some companies like to look after a lot of procurement stuff or have people in their office do that, or sometimes they'll want to outsource that completely to you. As I say, this is sort of just my experience, so you know, feel free to chip in what you think and what's happened to you. And then again, you know, some people want lots of input with things like the event safety management plan, budgeting and CDM and stuff. Other people are much more happy that you leave that to them. One thing I would say that no matter what happens with being a site manager, it's all about building a team around you that is your team, but then working alongside all those other teams. So that's why sort of it's a bit of a buzzword, but I really do believe that interoperability is key. And establishing those sort of short-lived but well-functioning, good communicating teams, especially when you're on site, you know, that communication, that teamwork is really key. And it makes everyone's life easier. So that will sort of run through this presentation. I'll try and kind of flag that, and I think you'll see it as I talk, how important I think that is, and I think most people agree. So moving on then, I've tried to break down site management into some key principles. As I say, it's funny when you're actually doing the job that you maybe don't really ever analyze exactly what it is you do. But as I did that, I kind of plucked out these six key areas, them being site design and site plans, procurement and contractor management, health and safety, finance, scheduling, and then staff management. If you are really into the site management and particularly the site design, site plan side of things, I'd highly recommend going back and having a look at the webinar that Rupert did last week. A brilliant webinar with loads and loads of insight into exactly what it is you're doing when you're planning and designing sites. I will touch on it in this presentation, but as again, if that really floats your boat, have a look at that. The procurement side of stuff, contractor management, I think in most roles within events, there is a level of this. And that's not to say that it's more or less important in site management, but it's definitely a key part of the role. Obviously, your contractors and your suppliers are basically a lot of the time the people actually building the shows for you. Health and safety, then, clearly it runs through everything you're likely to do. It's something that, you know, you want to be considering as early as possible. And, you know, everyone's got responsibility for this. So it's crucial that you are managing health and safety, and there's a strong focus there. Finance, it's pretty inevitable. In my opinion, it's definitely the more dull side of things. But clearly, there are budgets to be kept to, money to be made, and it's all part of the job. Scheduling, then, without doubt, it's the kind of hidden part of your time. You know, no one really appreciates how much time goes into it, I don't think. But without getting that right, you are going to struggle when it comes to actually building the site. So that's key there. Staff management, I've separated from procurement and contractor management just because inevitably you're going to have your own team that you run. And those guys will be, you know, your staff. And how you manage those will again have a big impact on how the show comes together. So let's get into it. The role, as I say, or this presentation, as I say, we'll look at those six key principles, but we're also going to look at the workflow of actually how as a site manager you would put a show together, and hopefully that sort of illustrate roughly what it is to do site management as an introduction. So as I said, there's four stages. First one of which is the advance. It's common amongst most event management functions, I'd say, and you know, a key to what we do. Within that, then, the site design and site plans are a really, really big part of that. I'd certainly say, in my experience, this takes up a lot of time, especially when you're on, you know, early shows. If it's the first or second year you've been involved in that show, or particularly if it's a new site or something like that, it will take up a lot of your time. Key things to start considering then. What is the show? What are the client's needs? What do they need from you? What's the scope of it? You know, who's arriving? How many people is it going to be? What's the type of show? What's that audience profile? What do they want from it? You know, do they want a really polished corporate looking show, or do they want something a bit more family orientated? Understanding what they need is crucial. Next, you'll end up, obviously, you've probably identified a site. Sometimes you won't have done, but normally they'll have somewhere they want in mind. And you need to get to know that place. You certainly need to get a good grasp of things, as it says there, you know, the safety stuff, your utilities, your overhead lines, all of that stuff. But equally, you're looking at things, you know, the typography, access to that site, how you're actually going to run that. Who owns it? You know, is it a number of farmers? Is it a local authority? And then who outside of that is the guy with the keys to the gates? Who's the guy with the access down the drive, all that sort of stuff? Make sure you get that information. And formalize it, you know, particularly if you only get one or two site visits. You know, if you're working abroad or it's a way to go to your site, you know, you need to make sure you've definitely got that information to hand and you're gathering it, because it's a bit of an effort to sometimes get to those sites. Borrowing slightly from what it is that Rupert was saying, when you're actually drawing these site plans and designing the site, there's sort of four key functions to that. One being the aesthetics and the feel of that show. You know, how are people going to enjoy it? How are they going to move around it? What's it going to look like? You know, what sort of structures do you want? What sort of fencing do you need? All of those sorts of basics that, you know, if you think of them early, are going to really improve the quality and the style of that show. Functionality then, that's not just how it's run when you've got people on site. It's not just, you know, which gates are where and who's doing what. It's also how you build it, how it gets put together. How it's serviced, you know, can your traders get in there to restock? Can your bars have enough space to replace all those empty kegs? As I've said, safety is going to run through this whole presentation because clearly it's one of the top priorities. At this stage in what you're doing, you definitely afforded the opportunity to remove any of the sort of major safety problems. You're looking at things, like your crowd flow, your capacities for venues, your sight lines, any sort of areas that are out of bounds, keeping your pedestrians separate from your vehicles, all of those sort of fundamental parts of safety. Anything you can do at this point to design out problems is all to the good. And then finally, commercials. Clearly somebody somewhere needs to at least be breaking even or feel the money you're spending is well spent. And more often than not, people are looking to make a profit. That's not just your promoter looking to sell tickets and have the bar revenue, so making sure the bar's in the right place. It's your traders who need to make a living. It's your sponsors who have generally paid a lot of money to be there. Make sure those commercial factors work within your site plan will keep a lot of people very happy. And hopefully keep you in a job. If you do that right, then the rest can be improved on as you go down the line. How do you draw it then? The absolute basics of a site plan, to my way of thinking at least, is it needs to be understandable by the people who are going to be using it and need to understand what you're building and what the site will be like. And as a minimum, it will probably need to be to scale. More often than not, licensing will stipulate that you need a site plan to scale. Easiest way of doing that, in my experience, I would say, and I think generally across the board, certainly for the bigger shows anyway, you'll be looking at a CAD program, whether that's Vectorworks or AutoCAD. It's up to you, different folks, different strokes on that one. One of the benefits of both of those is that you can then upload your drawings into GPS, which will massively help out your mark out. Last couple of points on this one then. So sharing it, reviewing it, and updating it. It's not just a plan for you and your team to build the show. It's a plan for everyone that's working on that show. The operations manager, the safety officer, the bars guys, they all need an input on it. They know best how they want their areas set up, their places to look. So share it with them. Make sure they get to see what you're planning and get that feedback and then update it. And then one that, I think at some point most people have been caught out somewhere along the lines, not just site plans, but across the board, that version control, there's nothing worse than having someone turn up on site looking at a plan that's 4 or 5 versions old and wondering why they're suddenly in the corner of the field as opposed to the edge of the field where they thought they were. So keep on top of it, make sure you're working through it. An example of the site plan there, it doesn't need to be super, super jazzy. It just needs to show people what it is they're doing and be clear and concise. Keys and things like that are always useful because especially local authorities will be looking at quite a lot of these and they'll need to know what it is you're drawing. So moving on from the site plan, from the site plan and generally working with everyone else as part of the team, you're going to start your procurement process, which is your specs, and bringing in those contractors. A lot of those specs will be very site plan orientated. Your fencing amounts and quantities, barriers, all of that type of stuff will come directly from your site plan. Other bits, not so much. Again, touching back on that aesthetic and how the site looks and what kind of kit you're booking, what type of toilets do people want? What type of structures do you want for your bars and your stages? What's that look? And then finally, just making sure that the kit you're getting in is what people need. There's multiple people working on that show and they need the right kit to be able to do their job. Quite a lot of the time, you're to an extent responsible for making sure that the people coming on site have got their power, their internet, their furniture, all of those basics they need to do their job. And, speaking to these suppliers is key. You quite quickly build up good relationships with certain suppliers and that's really useful. They'll be able to advise you sometimes on what kit you need. They'll have new bits of kit, different bits of kit, other ways of working. Trust them, speak to them, see what their thoughts are. At the end of the day, Harris fence is Harris fence, but equally, a stretch tent is clearly different from a trad. So, see what you fancy, see what kit they've got, make it look nice. Tendering processes. A lot of this will depend on your client to an extent. Some clients are super keen that everything goes out to full formal tender processes and clearly with huge contracts, there's advantages to that. Depending on the show, you may, just look at a couple of different options and make sure you're getting a decent price. And again, you're often going to have contracts you work with year in, year out. And those guys will be the guys you trust, but there's nothing wrong with keeping them on their toes, nothing wrong with making sure you're getting a good price from them and they're still, they still want to be paying the same attention to the show year five as they were year one. So, you know, speak to people, see what goes on. And then finally, all of those people you've booked, they need to know what you need. So send them the contractor packs, make sure they know the safety of your site, make sure they know when they're turning up, make sure they know who they're reporting to, all those basic bits and pieces. It's certainly a two-way street. They need to know things from you too. Sticking with the advance then, health and safety, as I said, I'm sure this is a big part of everyone's sort of thinking, but it's crucial to the site management, because you are, you know, building something that needs to be safe. It needs to be built safely, and it needs to stand up and carry on being safe throughout the show. As it says there, clearly competent contractors and suppliers are key. Working out how and who exactly is and isn't competent is an interesting thing to do. You know, it's a bit of an art form, but clearly you need it to be more than an art form. So you do need to be looking at things like the very basics, their insurance, their method statements, risk assessments, etc. But then looking at other bits and pieces, and making sure that the guys you are booking are good. CDM, it's a bit of an area within its own right. I know certainly on some of these webinars, it'll stir a good debate. I'm not going to go down that rabbit hole too much here. Suffice to say, there's certain parts within your advance you need to be doing. Obviously, construction phase plans, identifying the key roles, key contractors, all the rest of that is key here. Again, if you're super interested, there are other webinars on that topic specifically, so dig them out, have a look, see what you think. Working with your safety officer, I'm not a safety person myself, but I strongly recommend the sooner you can bring those guys in, the better. You know, you're going to be able to get information from them early on that will change how you do things, how your site is laid out. That is much easier to do when it's the click of a mouse in a site plan than it is to do when you've got to get, you know, 10 guys to move a tent 5 meters. So bring them in, work with them, and make sure that works. As I say, at the moment, the site design is very early. You know, you're in the advance. Nothing's been necessarily built. Nothing's set in stone. So ensure that you're working with that site to make it as safe as you possibly can. And you know, in the back of your mind, it should always be a consideration about why things go where they go. And then site rules, to my mind, things like site rules, site induction, CDM plans, weather management plans, it's always good to be asked. It's always nice to be involved in that. I wouldn't take it away from the people who put these things together day in, day out. You know, I don't know how Mark feels about these things and thinks about site rules and who should be writing them, and CDM plans and weather plans, and who should input on those. But I like a sort of a collaboration on that. You know, different people's experiences always help.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think as a general rule, the more good event people involved in feeding into the likes of those, A, the better a plan they'll be, but B, the more likely they are to be implemented by those people and their teams as well. You know, just the human condition, if we feel like we're involved in and bought into a process, we're much more likely to actually engage in it if the time comes. So things like the weather management plan and stuff like that, we would put a lot of it, I guess, initially back on the supplier themselves. So like a stage, I don't build and design stages for a living, so I would expect the staging company to be able to give me their weather management plan and their action levels, which I would then build into an overall plan. And, you know, I'd have a traffic light system for, you know, which stages we worry about at what wind levels and stuff like that. So it has to come from the suppliers to a large degree. But again, you don't want them just send you one thing and they never hear back and suddenly there's a plan. You'd always like a little bit of back and forth, even if, to be honest, you mentioned relationships earlier and how important they are. Even if it's just picking up the phone and going, look, anything changed with that one since the last time we used it? How have you guys been? How have you found it when you've put it out? Any dramas with high wind or with rain or anything to the roof leak? You know, just those conversations. You have to, sometimes there are things that won't get written down, I guess is what I'm saying. And if you have good relationships, you can probably still get to that bit of knowledge that might help you down the road, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think, as you say, it's all well and good in this advance to be building those plans. But at the end of the day, the people on the ground with you are going to be actioning them. So if they're part of producing them, then they should be able to action them much more easily. So thanks for that. I think it's all about the collaboration. Moving forward then through the advance, finance. I think it's pretty safe to say that most people who work in events didn't get into events to spend their whole time looking at spreadsheets and budgeting. You know, I certainly didn't look at this job and think, whoopee-doo, let me at that budget. But unfortunately, it is part of what we do. Key things here, obviously, are to know exactly what's in your budget, what you're responsible for there. Have a clear way of presenting it. Everyone's got their own ways. Quite often clients will need certain things in certain ways for that bigger picture. Get on board and understand that. And also make sure you know who is responsible for what. Again, keeping ahead of things for different departments, you're all going to be asked at some point by, your buyer's guy, how much is it going to cost me to have a telehandler for the week, for 2 weeks? How much will it cost me to have a second one? All of those things. The clearer grasp you've got of your budgets and your quotes for those things, the easier your job is going to be to make their job easier. Stay ahead of it. Keep on top of things. And then it's really, really boring, let's be honest with you, filing quotes, keeping invoices, keeping track of POs, keeping the spec up to date, all of that stuff. Is pretty boring, but it's totally fundamental to what you do. You'd never want to be in that position where each bit of that paperwork says something else and no one knows quite what's going to arrive and how much it's cost them. It's dull, but it's crucial. Scheduling, at this point, it's not fun. I'm not going to lie, it's putting all these things together isn't the glamorous fun side of things. But it is, again, how you make sure you're building the show properly, how you're making sure you're sticking to your schedules, how you're making sure that the right things are arriving at the right time. I'm bringing those people in, bring in those contractors, find out when they need to arrive to be able to put that stage up, how long it's going to take them to lay that exit route of trackway, anything like that that you can find out and get accurately right in your schedule is going to make things much, much easier when you come to site. Detailing, when are all those trucks going to arrive? Do you really want 20 trucks arriving at 8 a.m. on your second day on site when everyone's still, finding their feet? All of that sort of stuff will have a huge, huge impact on how well you put together that show and how easy it comes together and your stress levels. Make life easy, give yourself some breathing room, have a clear plan. That's not to say that you're not going to be able to juggle these things around. Clearly there's times when stuff has to change, but by having a good schedule there and knowing it will allow you to know when you can and can't make those changes, make those moves, and balance things out a little bit. And finally, as I touched on a little bit before, share it with people. You're not working in a silo. You're enabling the production manager to turn up to a stage that's built with an office that he can start working from. You're enabling the welfare team to have the right kit and heaters and tents and whatever else it is they need to do their jobs. Your final date will never be, or their final date, should I say, will never be when that gate opens. They're going to be arriving a week, 4 days, 3 days, 2 days before the show, and they will need you to be ahead of them. And so at this point, make sure when those other people are turning up, so you can be ready for them, and keep on top of that. Your staff will be, they'll be the backbone of your team. Normally, I think it's fairly safe to say you're going to know who you want to be your number two. You're going to know who you want to be running your site office. You know who you're going to want to be managing the plant, managing the boneyards, doing all those jobs that take just that bit of work off of your plate. And again, crews is a funny one. A lot of people can, there's lots and lots of wonderful crews out there that do a great job for you. Your site and stage, your rock cities, all of those guys. So book the right guys, know them by name, will always help you out. Equally, quite a lot of the smaller shows and independents will, not necessarily have the budgets to bring those guys in, but will need a crew. And so we'll look to you to bring in a crew of guys for yourself. One thing I'd say there, and again, I don't want to go down a rabbit hole of employment and employment laws and things, but when you are looking at that sort of stuff, you to an extent, become an employer. And there's a whole load of things there that you need to make sure you have in place to make sure that that is above board and done properly, you know, whether that's things to do with tax, to do with their safety, and all the rest of it. Make sure you're on top of that if you are contracting and bringing people in to work for you. Next one, jobs descriptions. Again, I'm by no means an HR manager, but I do absolutely know that if someone's told me clearly what they expect of me to do and what they want me to do, I will be much better at doing that than if somebody just gives me a job title, tells me to turn up in my steelies and high vis and crack on. You know, I think most people, if you can remember back that far, will have been in a position when they're a little bit lost, a little bit new, doing a new role, and I'm feeling whether they don't know whether they're coming or going or doing a good or bad job. And a lot of that comes down to whether they're being managed properly. So tell them what you need from them early and you'll get, you know, you'll get the best out of them and they will become a good part of your team. And finally then, you know, make sure that people have got the right safety information, make sure they know what they're turning up to do, make sure they get that in advance, and make sure that, you know, they are reading through it and understanding it. It's important that your team are just as well looked after and managed from that safety point of view as all the contractors and all those things you're expecting them to be doing for you. So moving on from the advance, the build, clearly this is the bit that I think most people will see. It's certainly the bit that is, to my mind, the most interesting and exciting bit. You're getting to put all those plans you've laid into action. So yeah, let's get into it. Again, we'll carry on these overarching principles. I'll carry on banging on about safety and banging on about working together and that interoperability. But the mark out is obviously the start of the build. You're transferring all that information from your wonderful site plan onto the ground. Old school, new school, GPS is really useful. There's no real getting away from it. If you're on a really big site and you know you need to get things done quickly, once that GPS is fired up and working, it's an absolute wonder. That's not saying you won't need to pull out your tapes. Nothing like a bit of maths on the ground there, or just making sure you're far enough away from the next thing precisely. So, you know, different folks, different strokes, but get that mark out right and things will start to fall into place much more easily. The site plan, you know, by the time you're on site, you want it to be in a position where everyone's signed off and everyone's pretty happy with it. But it will be updated. You know, you will get there and you will have found that that tree has definitely grown. Those park benches weren't there on that last site visit. Somebody's done a lovely job of clearing out that nice fresh ditch, but then put a load of soil next to the ditch, meaning you are now 5 meters from that ditch. You know, keep up to date. When you find those things out on the ground, make sure that site plan is updated, because again, that will make sure that the people coming in later, you know, your event controllers, your security teams, all the rest of it, have then got an up-to-date plan that they can work from, because you know everyone is relying on that plan to a certain extent to make sure their job comes together properly. And if you get a chance whilst you're there, take those notes, survey for the future. You know, hopefully you're going to be doing this show again and again for many years to come, and so if you can, you know, note down those, as I say, those benches, those bigger trees, whatever it is, you know, look to the future, make your life easier as you're moving through things. Contractor management. Your procurement's generally, to my experience, all but done here. You might need to buy some bits and pieces. You know, you might need some more consumables. You might need a bit more work with your teams cleaning your showers or whatever that sort of stuff is. But certainly the bulk of your procurement's done by now. And so it's down to managing them. It's down to how you work with your contractors that you've brought in to put this show together, and make sure you're trusting them, that you've booked these contractors for a reason. You've decided they're the best for the job, and trust in that, you know, trust what you've brought them in to do, trust that they can do it. Inevitably some of that will come down to experience and coming down to the you know, the feel you get from the guy on the ground. You know, how he's managing it, how he's getting on with it. More often than not, the guy you've been speaking to or lady you've been speaking to in the office won't be the person turning up to site to actually build it. Again, this is why that working together, the interoperability, the teamwork, and building those relationships nice and early is key and makes everyone's life easier. As part of that, you obviously need to be giving people the information they need to get on with their job. So get into a rhythm, you know, get into the routine of your briefings, of your daily meetings, of catching up with contractors. Briefings at the start of the day, you know, particularly if you're running your own crews or, you know, you're working with crew chiefs, they need to know what you need from them that day. They need to know, you know, how, where you're expected to be by the end of the day, all those basics. If you make that into a routine and they know that they'll get that information first thing in the morning from you, everyone's life's much easier. And similarly, a daily meeting, you know, that sort of time at 5-6 o'clock, when there's a bit of time left to make some changes before the next day, getting everyone together, having that chat is really useful. You know, one, it means you can keep an eye on, you know, people's scheduling, help them out with certain things, make an adaptation here and there to make their job easier. But it also means that the sparkies are going to know that the plumbers are all going to be stood around outside the site office at 5-6 o'clock. And if they need that quick conversation about making sure the power goes to that pump in that campsite, that can happen then. You know, it gives people a framework to work to, and by building that in, I think you know it's a good way of getting the most out of your contracts and your teams. And then finally on this one, then a bit of delegation. You know, you normally certainly on the larger shows, you're going to have an assistant site manager, a couple of assistant site managers, site coordinators, whatever you want to call them, but you're going to have a couple of guys that are your deputies, as it were, and they're going to be working with you and working for you. So make sure they know what you need of them. Make sure you've given them a couple of contractors to look after. Divide up that role. You know, there's going to be times where you're possibly needed in three places at once. But if you've given those assistant site managers the opportunity to manage your cabins company and your trackway company and your marquee company, well, it speeds things along if they can go straight to that guy and get the answers they need whilst you're sat down chatting away to the promoter about something that you're probably rolling your eyes about at that very moment, but is all part of the job. So, you know, make the most of your team and let them manage things, and it'll make your life much, much easier. Health and safety, then, build health and safety. This is obviously the point at which most of your hazards are likely to start cropping up. And all of your wonderful planning should be coming to fruition. CDM compliance, as we touched on before, there's a lot in that in terms of making sure your construction phase plans are together, making sure you're letting the HSE know if you need to, making sure that you know who's your principal contractors and designers are and all that sort of stuff that's gone in advance, which is lovely when you've got it written down in a wonderful document. But you need to make sure you are complying with that on the ground and that you actually sticking to what you said you're going to stick to. Inductions is a little one. It comes across possibly as a bit of an obvious thing these days. I think pretty much every site these days will have a decent induction for people to do before or after, whether they arrive on site and do it or whether they do it online before they get there. But I think sometimes what is important to remember here is actually it's the first interactions that people have with the safety of your show, and it's about setting that safety culture and letting them know that when they're, you know, when they're working on this show for you, that, you know, you're taking safety seriously, and they need to get on board with that, and keep their eyes open there. Clearly that sort of runs through all of the basics, collecting tickets and licenses, having ways of doing that, making sure they're there, making sure the paperwork's in place. It all seems very basic, but it's those sorts of things that will, you know, should the very worst happen, that will be needed to be looked through and checked and, you know, make sure you're on top of those. Toolbox talks, again, I think they're very common these days. I certainly think that your larger contractors and your more professional contractors have certainly built these things into their working practices. But it's always worth making sure they're happening, and certainly making sure that you're talking through with your guys at the start of every day. What it is they're looking out for, what sort of job they've got, and what those, you know, specific hazards are to the work they're undertaking. Again, these equipment checks, tools, plant, all the rest of it, it's wonderful to have the best written event safety management plan that says you're going to make sure you comply with every regulation under the sun to do with this, but you need systems in place to do that. You know, you need to make sure that your plant manager or your site office manager is making sure those equipment checks are being carried out, making sure that the only right people are getting hold of those keys, making sure that any issues with that plant are getting reported back to the depots and that they're sending the fitters out to get it fixed. Because at the end of the day, that's basic safety stuff, but it's the stuff that can trip you up quite quickly. And so stay on top of it. Make sure those things are in place. Moving on then to certain things. Different sites are always going to have their own different hazards. Don't want to get too bogged down in this, but you know, it, at a minimum, you're going to need your safe working zones for any lifting sort of activities. Permits to work, clearly, if you're going near underground services, possibly working outside your fence lines, all of that sort of stuff. Make sure you've got these things in place. And sometimes, again, I mean, it depends what teams you're working with and what your safety officer wants from you, but sometimes they might be more than happy to start helping you out here a little bit. And you know, jumping in and signing off with these permits and checking that people are, once they've got the permit, actually sticking to what that permit says as well. Weather here, you know, whether you're in the UK or abroad, you know, the weather can change at the drop of a hat. It's more often than not over here, it's more often rain and wind, although it can certainly be the sun at certain times as well. Keep ahead of it. It's brilliant to have your lovely anemometer on the top of your stage there telling you that you're fine and you don't need to do a show stop because you're well within your safe limits. But actually, it's even or as important, if not more important, to know that that weather is coming in of sort of 8, 10, 12 hours in advance, and making sure that you know that you've got your plans in place and that your site is ready for that storm or that heavy wind and rain, you know. Keep that weather check and make that somebody's responsibility, whether that's your site office manager, your safety officer, preferably a couple of people who every day are having a quick look at that and you know, flagging any potential issues. And clearly your safety team here, whether that's one or two of them or whoever it is, are key. You know, you hopefully have worked out how you want to work together, you know, how hands-on they want to be, like to be, where they like to go, what sort of things they like to be involved in. And you know, as I say, keep including them. Certainly things like barriers and any sort of configurations around crowd movements, all those sorts of things, it's well worth getting a second opinion on that, I think, and making sure that you're working with that team and getting their advice, because you know, their opinion certainly matters there. So moving through, as I say, that's a check sheet and a spreadsheet that most people are going to, you know, be using. Having these things set out and ready for you before you come on site, for making sure that your plant forks and bits and pieces of kit are all ready to work is really useful. Finances, just keep it up to date. You will be spending money on site. You know, it's part of what you do. It's not fun, but if you're on top of it and you know that, you know, it's going to take you 20 minutes to sort of double check it before you send it on to that promoter who will inevitably want it on the, you know, the Wednesday before doors when you've got 1,001 other things going on, it's much better to have spent all those half an hours keeping on top of it than have to spend half a day getting it ready for them. You know, they're going to ask for it at the most inconvenient time, so have it ready. Scheduling, this is where, if you've got this right, you can sit back and feel very proud that your site is running like absolute clockwork. That ballet of the trackway going down, followed by the tent going up, followed by the power going in, is a wonderful thing to watch if you've got it right. So clearly here, you know, you're using your schedule to make sure that you're on target, you're hitting the goals and the deadlines you've set yourself and you've set with other departments. But don't be afraid to juggle it. You know, if you know you're going to do a job that's highly weather dependent and the weather looks like it's going to turn, make sure that you know that you're confident to move that job, where else it can fit in, what other jobs you can be doing in its place, and be a bit nimble with it. You know, be ready to make those changes. Again, you know, looking back on that weather, blistering hot days, you've got a load of guys out there throwing up Harris fence because, you know, it's what they love doing and it's what they're there to do. You don't want to be killing them through lunchtime. You know, you might well be better giving them a long lunch and working a bit later so that no one's dying of heat exhaustion. Those sort of little tricks there to keep people moving, keep people working, is well worth considering. You know, be proactive with it. Make sure that if you are making those changes and people are falling behind or getting too far ahead in some examples, make sure they know that. Make sure they know what you need from them and when. It's no good that this schedule is something that you've built over 6 months and have in your head if the people that are meant to be sticking to it and working to it don't know what it is. So again, share, work as a team, and make sure that that information is passed around to everyone who needs it. Your staff are the guys at the moment, or girls. I keep saying guys, and it's a bad habit, so apologies on that one. But make sure that your team are all part of it. You know, make sure that you're running them as much as you're running all the contractors. Make sure they're part of those morning briefings, those evening chats. Make sure they're part of that. I've put up a jobs board there because, you know, different folks, different strokes. There's a million and one different apps, whether it's your to-do or your Wunderlist, that are great for these job boards. But to my way of thinking, whilst those apps all have a really useful place, there is nothing quite like a jobs board that you can stand there with your contractor and cross stuff off, have that conversation, make sure the detail of what those jobs are is passed over clearly, rather than somebody missing a load of notifications on their phone in their pocket, or, you know, charging in their hotel room or van or whatever it is. And again, your crew and your crew chief, they're part of your team. You know, make sure they know what they're up to, make sure they've got that information. It goes without saying that these guys are the guys on the ground building your show. And the more involved they feel, and the more included in that teamwork, the more you're going to get out of them, and the better it will go. There's nothing worse than people winging it and having to change stuff. You know, get it right first time, make sure they get the information they need to get it right first time, is extremely important. And again, safe management, safe systems of work, working together, making sure those plant licenses all come together, you know, delegate that stuff. Make sure that the person who you have delegated that to knows that's their responsibility, how you want it to run, how you need it to look, and more importantly, why. You know, quite often, you know, people will be given a job and do it very well, but if they actually know why they're doing it, they can probably do it better. And the final one there, I think we sort of touched on it, but the safety and the welfare of these guys is really important. You know, you're directly responsible for that if you've brought them onto that show. More often than not, in many circumstances, these guys are going from show to show back to back without huge breaks. So, you know, if you can get them that bit of clean washing, or give them that big fridge of cold drinks or whatever it is, it just makes their life better. It makes them more involved. It makes things easier for everybody. And, you know, it's nice to look after people, and it's nice to be looked after. Definitely bear that in mind as you go along. A lovely example of a jobs board. Clearly, it's important that people can read it. I'll be honest, that's not my handwriting. So if you do happen to have a site manager with great handwriting, take full advantage. And you'll notice that some guys have done a very good job and others maybe not so much. But anyway, here we are. It's the show. You've done it. You've hit doors. Everything's been marvellous. And I thought, you know, there's not many shows on at this moment. So let's have a little look at what a show might look like, just for a bit of nostalgia. There's a short video here. I promise it's not advertising. It's just maybe nice to see a minute of what a show can look like when hopefully we get to do them again in the future. Oh, how nice is it to see a show? What a thing they are. So the show's on. Everyone's having a great time, as you know, it's clear to see. So now is unfortunately not the time to sit back and put your feet up. It would be lovely to do that. It might even be nice to go and grab a pint and watch a band. But the reality is you're playing that supporting role. you know, you're making sure that those fence breaches are clipped back up. You're making sure that the arena's ready to open. You know, depending on the show, there might be all sorts of changes that happen overnight, or with resetting gates, or with, you know, the traffic management or queues or whatever it might be that you need to reset and keep on top of. You've still got a lot of contractors that you're responsible for working. You know, your toilet guys are out there, your power guys are out there, you know, refueling generators, your waste management, obviously keeping on top of those bins, doing the litter picks, all the rest of it. So the show does go on. You are still working. That said, you know, do make sure you build in some downtime. Your crew will have probably worked really hard up to that point. A lot of the time, certainly in my experience, when I was crew, you know, a part of the reason you do it is because you love the shows, or you know, you get a buzz out of those events. So it's nice to be able to give them a bit of time to have a look at it and enjoy the fruits of their labor. And finally, now is the time, if you do get that half an hour, that afternoon, that morning, whatever, to make sure that your site plan and all those bits and pieces that you might have tweaked, changed, updated, amended, are all lining up. You know, if you've got the time, plan for next year, stay ahead of things. And it's much easier to check something whilst you're there on the ground than it is to try and remember it 4 months down the line after you've delivered another three shows. So, you know, you use this time wisely, but try and get some enjoyment out of it if you can. Because all too soon you'll be taking it down again. So we're on to the break now, the sort of final leg of this journey, I guess. Certainly, to my way of thinking, as important as the build. You know, now is not the time to be losing focus. If you've, you know, if you're in a nice big stately home or in a big posh park or whatever it is, you've still got a lot of responsibility to make sure that that site gets given back to those guys as neatly as possible. That's not to say you shouldn't be looking after that farmer's field. It's just to say that it gets very expensive very quickly if you start trashing parks, because everyone wants to scramble out and run home. I've jumped a little bit ahead of myself then. We will just mention the site plan. As I said before, it's useful to make changes. It's useful to keep it up to date. If you can find that promoter, that client, you know, if you can wake them from their slumber in their hungover hotel room somewhere, ask them what they thought of the site, see what feedback they've got, walk it with them. It's good to do that whilst they're still there and it's fresh in everyone's mind. Your contractors, clearly you need to keep on top of these guys, make sure they're taking everything down, doing the right thing. Without wanting to overstate it, now is the time when stuff can start going wrong. You know, people are tired, people want to get it gone. But you need to keep their focus, keep them safe, make sure that everything's working to plan. And making sure that they know what they need to do, you know, make sure that they're not taking stuff out too early. You know, there's nothing worse than having to build something when you're trying to take it down because it's come out too early. Keep an eye on them, you know, with all the greatest will in the world, you know, even your very best contractors can forget something, leave something behind. And you don't want to be the person having to get your guys to stick it in a van and run it back to them because they haven't got any crew because they're all on to the next show. So, you know, work with them, keep an eye on them. As I say, make sure it's done properly first time. They don't want to be coming back to collect something or put something back in if you've told them it can come out when it can't. Work with them, make sure that you're sticking with it. Collection notes there. It'll seem like a bit of a minor point, but I promise you it will be the thing that saves you when, for some reason, a load of kit apparently has gone missing, but clearly hasn't because you have the collection note and it's still in the back of their yard because somebody somewhere has done something obscure with it. It's certainly not on your site, and sometimes you'll need to be able to show people that they have actually collected that kit. Keep on top of them. It will save your bacon at some point or another. And then again, whilst they're there, whilst it's clear in their mind, have a quick chat. You know, what did your plumbers think of the gig? What would make their life easier? How was it for the waste management team? You know, was that skip in the right spot for them? Was it really difficult not being able to bring the bin wagons in because of the egress? You know, what was it that you can change for next year that's fresh in their mind then that you can learn? I think there's a posh term these days, you know, if you want to do a hot debrief, get that information from them and steal it, make sure you're working with it. Health and safety. Clearly, it's important for everybody from the start to the finish. But actually, at this point, as I sort of touched on before, is the point when people, to my experience, more likely to make those mistakes, be a bit tired, be a bit gung-ho, And so you need to make sure that people are, you know, still focused on that safety, and you know, not rushing, not falling over one another, not, you know, not making the simple mistakes that eventually means people get hurt. Those first 48 hours, you know, there's a lot of people on site all trying to get off at that first stage, whether that's your production trying to get out, your traders trying to get off site. A lot of the departments will be clearing off, you know, mostly medics will be gone, mostly welfare, etc., security, whoever else will all be leaving. So, you know, keep on top at that time, especially keep things as tight as you can and keep reminding people that at this point, safety is still key. Finance is still there, it's still lingering over you. It's essentially wrapped up by now. Keep the budgets reconciled. Don't lose those receipts. It will be somewhere in some random short pair of shorts somewhere, but it's much better to find them, keep hold of them, than it is to be searching for them in 2 weeks' time when you're trying to reconcile that budget. And, you know, it's always nice to have your budget in good shape as much as you possibly can. It's what can win or lose you a job after all. At the end of the day, the finances count for a lot. Scheduling. As much as I've said everything is important at these times, scheduling on the way out is certainly as important as on the way in. It's possibly more important than the build here, just because, you know, you need to keep people moving. Everyone wants to get away early, but you need to get it done in the right order. Load in to load out. It's an old one, but I really think it's a good one. You know, make sure that when you're putting all this together, you know that you can get access to all those stillages. You know, you can sneak in that truck the night before so that your production teams can start getting a load out going whilst you're not waiting for your traders to all leave. All of that sort of stuff, anything you can do to be ahead of things when you're trying to get rid of it will make stuff faster. And just avoid that chaos of trying to get everything out at once. You know, there is only so much space behind that main stage, and you don't want to be sending all of your contractors there at once so that you've got your stage coming down when your cabins are coming out, when the power's coming out. You know, think it through, separate out people, give them the space they need to do their job, and everyone's life will be, you know, will be much, much easier. It can get quite stressful on these loadouts. So plan ahead, let people have some space and some time. And keep what you need. You know, certainly at the end of a gig, you're still going to need your Wi-Fi. You're still going to need your radios and a bit of power. Make sure you've still got them. Don't let them go too early, especially if for whatever reason you haven't necessarily booked them. Make sure that you have got them, because you don't want to be stuck as the last team on site without the kit you need to do your job. And as ever, you will always want more plant. You cannot have enough forklifts in this situation normally. So make sure that that's planned into exactly what you're doing, because there's nothing worse than having people stood around waiting for kit to be able to do their job. And again, it's an old one, but I think it is a really good one. More haste, less speed. You know, get it right first time, get it out properly, have all the kit you need when you need it, and you will all get home much more easily than if you just try and rip it out as fast as possible. Staff management, again, they're still here. This is the time when people's heads start to drop, when people have been there for what seems like forever, when there's no excitement for the show, where, you know, more than likely it's a bit of a wet, muddy field, or it's a big empty space that you're working in and it all looks a bit dismal compared to how lovely it looked when the show was on. So keep that, you know, keep that motivation up. There's nothing like a good bit of food or a treat to go out for some dinner or whatever those sort of nice little touches you are that you can provide to keep people's spirits up. Keep sharing that information. You know, just because people were doing a marvelous job during a build or during a show doesn't mean that they're going to keep their eye on the ball quite as much for the break. So keep sharing that information, keep them in the loop. You know, the end is in sight, but they still need to cross that finish line and need the information to be able to do that job. It's boring, but it's true. Inventories of kit that you're going to need again in the future. It's so tempting just to load that container, wedge that door shut, force it shut with five guys and not think about it until the next year. But that next year, you are not going to enjoy opening that container. So get it right. Make sure you know what you've got. Make sure you're not buying stuff twice. It's boring, but it's worth it. And as I say, think about next year. You know, hopefully if you've got it right this year and for the future years, you're going to be back again and again. And so anything you can do to make your job easier for that next year is all to the good. And just because it was a wonderful example of probably the best stored signage I think I've possibly ever seen, there is an example of somebody who's definitely dedicated to that storage of kit and keeping things safe and together. So I think that pretty much brings us to the end of things. It was very much a whistle stop tour of my take, at least on an introduction to site management. Hopefully I've maybe pricked your interest somewhere where there might be a few questions or a bit of a chat we can have. But yeah, I hope you've enjoyed it. And that's pretty much me.
Thanks for that, Tom. I have, look, you know, because I told you this yesterday and when we've been talking about the presentation, I think it's really good. I think the way you structured it was really good. And I think that seems to have been borne out in the chat and the debate that's kind of ensued as you went through it. I think the structure, keeping to the six or seven kind of main areas through the four stages, I think worked really well and gave people a great kind of a framework. Mm-hmm. Again, we've a lot of really experienced people in the room, but then we also have a lot of people who were messaging me going, can we have the slides, please? Because I can't scribble all this stuff down fast enough. Do you know what I mean? So that kind of a framework is invaluable for some of them, like we thought it might be. I'm not going to lie, I might steal that framework myself.
No, help yourself.
We might send out, I think Tom's okay with us sending out the slides when I'm emailing things out, guys. So don't worry about that. Look, there's been a good few questions that come up. I've tried to grab them all. As usual, just let me put the raise your hand to speak thing live in case anyone wants to do that. That's cool. Live now. So if anyone wants to turn their own mic on and ask a question, that option is there. Sometimes technology works against us on that one, but we'll give it a go if anyone wants. First question for you, my friend. Do you prefer a narrow brief or a broad brief when you're brought in on a job? So would you prefer to be looking after all the bits you can look after? Or would you prefer to just have one kind of straightforward element to do?
I think a lot of that would depend on exactly the show that's being delivered. You know, I think a lot of people have, you know, got their ways of working in their areas where they feel comfortable and when they're more than happy to take on, you know, the bulk of it and be that guy there at the top running the whole lot from top to bottom. That said, you know, if someone's chucked me into a situation where I perhaps felt I needed a bit more experience or it was something a bit new to me, I'd probably, you know, go down that line of picking up a key part of that and running with it. But then also I think, you know, it's always really fun if you do get a client that comes to you and says, I can open a can of worms now, but you know, I need to put on a load of cars in the field to do a gig. How do I do that? It's always great fun. And sometimes it's nice to have a wide brief of this is what I want to achieve, how do I do it, than it is, you know, I want 5,000 people, I want exactly this site, I need it to look exactly like this, and it needs to cost exactly this much money. So, you know, it's I guess that was me evading the question to a point. I think my preference is generally to take charge and know exactly what it is I'm delivering and be overall in charge. But it'll vary depending on the show.
Yeah, I think that's a good caveat to start with. I think you and I are here both probably thinking of clients and events where, yeah, I'd love to be doing it all, and Jesus, no, I'll stick to doing the bit I'm doing. Thanks. Listen, there's absolutely one here that's just come in again, that's come in a few times, and it's on my list. Do you use any software or any tech to do your scheduling? I mean, a couple of people have mentioned still doing it kind of on pen and paper, that they're old school, and they're wondering what could they move to that's kind of proven and that works. What do you guys do?
I'll be honest, at the moment, just because I find it the easiest way to share and everyone has that capability, I do a lot of mine just on an Excel. I find it the easiest way of one, getting all the information out of my head and into that sort of format.
Yeah.
But then again, you know, most people will have a reasonable idea of how to use it and what to do with it and can read it. If I'm honest, it is one of those parts of the business, I guess, that I am looking to try and find one of those solutions that works. I've worked for different clients that use different things, and I think to a point when they work really well.
Yeah.
I just sometimes fear that if you're having to introduce that software to a lot of different teams across a lot of different shows, certainly till it's bedded in, you spend a lot of time, you know, working out the nuts and bolts of it, and actually using that software becomes a bit of a bore. But as I say, I'm no expert on these things. And if anyone has got any great tips out there of what works for them, it's always good to share, you know?
Yeah, no, I think one of the things with my mother, I always quote my mother, she's an accountant, and she has told me since I've been old enough to understand that Excel is infinitely more powerful than everybody realizes.
Yeah.
So she's always extolled the virtues of Excel. But I think the beauty of Excel is, again, that format that people are used to.
Mm-hmm.
And with Google Docs and stuff, you can very easily do your stuff in Excel and make it a Google Doc and shareable really quick with live updates and stuff. So I think you're right. There's all sorts of software out there. We're similar. We've used different types of things along the way. But invariably, we always have some element of an Excel at the underpinning it all. Because you can share it quite easily. People can update it and you can change it live and stuff by using Google Docs. So
And I think like you say, there's quite a lot you can get out from that. You know, if you do want to go right down the sort of the whole Gantt chart type stuff and all the rest of it, you know, you can pull those things out quite readily. And again, you know, not everyone needs to know everything about the whole schedule. You know, why would your plumber want to know when the road signs are going out? You know, it doesn't matter to them. But if you can find a way, and I can, or most people I think can, through Excel and finding the bits that relate to them, then it makes everyone's life that much easier, you know?
No, 100%. I think, again, lots of tools out there, folks, but Excel can do a lot for you. There's an interesting one from Rachel, who's been working in various roles and events for 15 years, she says, and is just wondering, 10 years working in the ticketing side for festivals, have you any advice on a route into the site management side of things? We get these on most of the webinars, is how do you get Tom's job? How do you get to there? You mightn't even realize it, but there are some people looking at you going, I want that job. That is the dream job. That is what I want. So any advice on how someone might work their way into that kind of a role from a different element of their business?
Yeah, I mean, I think, certainly from my point of view, I was very lucky that I had some really good mentors. So if you're, if you're on your way, I know by the sounds that Rachel's got a lot of experience, so you know, it's kind of maybe to the side, but I will come on to that. If you're working your way up into it, you know, coming from just starting out, whatever it might be, get yourself that mentor. Find people out there that you like working with, that you look up to, that you respect, and that you will generally, in my experience, find that the good people out there and the people who really know what they're up to will more than happily share that knowledge, teach you things, pass information on, and you know, take you under their wing. Certainly I did, and I benefited from that. To transition across from somebody that's obviously got that experience but maybe in a different field, possibly literally, people, you know, go and chat to the people who you'd want to be working for. You know, if you're on the site with them already, you know, pick your moment, but poke your head into the site office and see if you can grab 10 minutes to have a cup of tea, or, you know, a 5 minute chat at the end, or, you know, even at least get their details and let them know what you want. Because I think if you're telling somebody that you're really keen to do, you know, whatever it is, site office work, site work, crewing, whatever it might be, if you're going to somebody telling them that's what you want to do, then it's not that difficult for them to try and make that happen for you. You know, I think if it's a clear thing that you're wanting and you can express that to somebody, then 9 times out of 10 they'll do their best to make that happen for you. So have a conversation, have a chat, just approach the people you can when you can. And then outside of that, I know we're not always on site, but there's things, you know, there's all sorts of, I guess it's a bit different these days, but there are a lot of trade sort of shows out there and trade meetings and all the rest of it. So get along to those, you know, go and chat to different people, and just network and use your network as much as you can, I think.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. I think, Rachel, although to you it may not feel like it, but you have a definite advantage in that it sounds like you're already on the sites.
Mm-hmm.
So again, Tom's right, like, pick your moment, obviously, but if you're on site, introduce yourself to the people that in theory you'd like to be mentored by or work with, to make sure they know what you do, that you're interested in getting involved in what they do. That's the first step. And you'll know, you know, depending on how that's received and what kind of person that person is and everything, you'll know if there's hope there and if you should keep in touch. You know, busy on site, they'll probably say, oh, send me a mail, do whatever. You know, then you've made a bit of a connection, then you're into a good follow-up, and just look, trying to get that first opportunity. I think the hardest thing for And there's another quick question in here about a graduate from a graduate. I think the hardest thing is just getting that foot in the door. Yeah. So Rachel, from your perspective, if you're on sites doing something and if you've that much ticketing experience, you know, you're coming to them going, well, look, I'm clearly good at festival stuff. I'm on site doing something. I think I'd be good at what you guys do and I'd love a chance to just get involved and help you out a bit and then just follow up with those. But again, it can seem weird, but be picky enough, like find good people and people you think you'd learn from. You might be on a site, the first time you're on a site now after us having this talk, you might be inclined to jump at something, but just make sure they're the type of people you think you could work with and talk to people working for them and with them and see what they're like. But Tom's right, there's a lot of people in the industry very willing to help. Now, don't get me wrong, loads of people want to work in events. Loads of people want to move from what they're doing into a different part of events. So, I mean, it's a quite crowded marketplace. So at that stage, you're back to the normal thing we say to everyone, which is stand out somehow. The somehow doesn't really matter, to be honest, but stand out, get in front of them. And again, you've got a great advantage because you're on site already. Just pick your moment. Be the one who brings them the tea or the coffee or the jellies or whatever. That'll get their attention as long as they're not in the middle of something critical. And it's just about how you approach it, I think. Zoe is here wondering from a graduate perspective. So she graduated last year and has been involved in sports events. And she's now looking to take the steps, you know, into maybe more green, I think, into the greenfield side of things. Any different type of advice, Tom, for someone at that stage in their career looking to kind of, or is it pretty much the same? Stand out, find yourself a chance, get a foot in the door. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think the point you're making about standing out is a good one. You know, as you say, there's lots of people wanting to do this work to a point. And if you can remember them for whatever reason that might be, it's good just to have that connection. I think as well, there's just building your experience wherever you can. You know, it might not be exactly where you want to end up, where you find yourself working at that very moment. But you know, if you've got a great venue down the road from you, or you know somebody who does something to do with it that you want to do, go and pick up that experience with them. You know, I don't think you always have to know exactly what everyone else's job is that you're doing, but I also think it definitely helps if you can have experience across a lot of different disciplines so that you get a rough idea of what it is, one, that you want to do, and two, what it is other people do. And a really good way of doing that, certainly early on, is by just going out there and getting what experience you can. You know, it find that crewing agency, maybe find the lighting company, possibly find, you know, whatever floats your boat, and get in touch with them and try and pick up some work with them, you know. And then as soon as you've got your foot in the door, as you say, you quickly get an idea of whether you do like it as much as you thought you would, whether there's actually a completely different path that you love, you know. And then you know that you are on the right track, and you can start to sort of wind your way up and speak to the right people and move forward, I think. So yeah, it's a balance of experience, and it's a balance of getting that experience from the right people who are keen to help you out, I guess.
And it's that catch-22 of, you know, sometimes you can't get work without experience but you need someone to give you a shot. So mm-hmm. It really is. And I say this all the time to people. Honestly, if you're good, the hardest bit is getting the foot in the door and getting onto site doing something.
Yeah.
You know, once you're good and you're known to be good and your attitude is good, other opportunities appear and you create some for yourself. But like, unfortunately, in this game at the minute, the hardest bit is that first bit. It's to get in there doing something. And as you said, maybe there's an opportunity to get on site doing X. And that'll give you the opportunity during breaks or shifts where you're not working to explore why and go and talk to those people. And I would think you're right. Take those opportunities and be cognizant that your first entry, the door you go in first, may not be the door you've been imagining through your 4 years or 3 years in college. But it's a door, and you need to get in and then get in front of people, I think.
Yeah, completely agree.
Yeah, there was a good question came in very early on. I'm glad I scribbled loads down because I knew, I just knew they'd scroll off the bottom of the screen for me. So in your opinion, what's the difference between, or how do you view site management versus production management, technical management kind of?
My way of thinking about it, and I'm sure there's lots of ways of thinking about it, is production management and certainly technical production management, and I'm probably going to get a bit of a shooing from everyone that does technical production management here, is the sort of the boundary to me is if it's on the stage, if it's on the pad next to the stage, if it's involving anything to do with your lighting and your sound and your, you know, your pyro, your screens, all the rest of it, that's your production manager, your technical production manager. If it's, you know, the rest of the infrastructure around that, whether that is the trackway pad for the stage or the cabin they're working from, then that's your sort of your site management team. The lines definitely blur depending on what you're working on and who you're working with in the shows. Yeah. But as a general rule, that's certainly how I see it.
One of the things that can be confusing in our industry, and we've kind of caused the problem, I think, is there are people and busy people who work on lots of different shows who actually fill different roles on different shows.
Yeah.
So you could see them on site and go, oh, he was the production manager on the last gig we were on. And again, he could be doing site on that or something. We do seem to have some really good experienced people in the industry who can move across some of those roles, and that can even be confusing if you're trying to pinpoint someone that you want to follow up with. So
definitely. And I think also sometimes as well, you know, there's different titles for the same or similar jobs, exactly, as well. So
and that can change, and again, titles can change job to job. The title could be different, but as you said, the role could be the same. It, you know, it depends what part of the world you're in. It can even depend what part of the country you're in. Charlie had a good question earlier on. Do you think people overstress about CDM? He made the point, and I've heard him make this point before, that like a good event management plan that has all the key detail we all tend to have in our plans goes an awful, awful long way towards ticking all those CDM boxes. So he's just wondering, do you think it can be one of those stressors for people when, if you're good and you've always been good about doing your planning, you're probably well more than halfway there?
Yeah. I mean, I think, I mean, not to be boring about this here, but
I agree.
Yeah. I definitely think that, you know, if you look, and I'm certainly not a massive CDM expert, but I think if you look at the intention behind bringing that CDM things into the events is essentially for safety and to make sure that things are being done safely and well. And then more than that, they're being documented in a relatively standardized fashion. And so, as you say, if you are already doing those things safely and well, and you've got good working practices within that, then yeah, you're definitely well over halfway to complying already.
And I think I've heard Charlie make the point before that I think when CDM came in first in the UK, even then, if people stood back and reviewed what they'd been doing for years, they were well on their way to having it nailed for CDM. So for a lot of people, it wasn't the big, you know, looming specter that for others it was, because maybe they weren't already operating that way. So I think there was an interesting thing at the time that when you watch the commentary coming from people who were kind of stressing or flipping out about it, those of us in the industry kind of went, if it's stressing you that much, you probably haven't been maybe doing it the way you should have. And I think there was a lot to read between some lines there.
I think that's fair. I would say that slightly on the flip side of that, I think that certain organizations and certain groups possibly put a real weight behind that whole CDM and complying with those regulations to, you know, to a point to satisfy them and you know, I'm sure with good intention. But I think that's the point at which possibly the CDM stuff does become more than stuff you would normally do. And then, you know, there are those experts out there that you can bring in to make sure that, you know, you are complying and they are qualified, whatever that might mean, to be the principal contractor or whatever it is. Yeah. And so if you find yourself in that position, you know, there's help out there. The reality is, unless you are an expert in this, you don't have to know the ins and outs of all of it. You just need to know that if you need help with it, where to get that help.
And obviously not to downplay the importance of CDM, you can have small shows that are extremely complex with long bills. We have one of those where we don't have CDM in Ireland, but we have a similar type of a system and regs we work within. So we have a long build, smaller capacity, long running show that gets right into all the CDM type stuff, even though no one would think of it as a huge, massive festival in a green field. You know what I mean? So
definitely
it's important. someone asked earlier, I can't remember who it was, I didn't scribble down names, someone sent it to me by accident, I think, instead of putting it in the room, but wanted to know, I don't know, is this a crack at both of us because we don't have much hair?
Okay, go on.
Want to know, you know, like after doing all your builds and everything and dealing with the stress, getting it on track, and you're the night before doors, and then the example he gave was, you know, the promoter comes in or VIPs suddenly arrive, throwing the cat amongst the pigeons, wanting tours of things and all this. He goes, how do you stop yourself having effectively managed so much of it so well when those types of things happen that you have to facilitate because it's the promoter or whatever? How do you stop yourself pulling your hair out? And I think I'm going to assume the best. I'd say it wasn't a crack at both of us being bald, but that being the case, the way I would view that is, if I've managed as much, I suppose you control the controllables basically. Mm-hmm. If I've managed everything as well as I can, I'm always prepared for the random. And you have to be. And yes, you're right, the random will often come in the form of the promoter doing something, and they are the promoter, so most things they want to do, you need to let them do. So, but my thing is, if you can manage well everything you can manage well, well then you're okay with the random stuff happening. And that really should be what we're there for. We're there then for the random, the truck breaking down, something going behind schedule, VIPs arriving when they weren't supposed to, but they have to be looked after. All of that kind of stuff should be what we end up dealing with and not having to worry about the other 98%, I guess, is where my head needs to be.
Yeah. I mean, the flippant answer there is, if you don't want to pull out your hair, don't have any hair, you know, and we're both winning.
I'm getting messages from people now going, I'm bald too, and I think it's from doing this work.
But yeah, I think you're right. I think if you're ready and prepared for those things, you can deal with them, you can pick them up. There's definitely an element of you know, biting your lip and taking a deep breath at points. But equally, I think it will depend on the relationship you have with those people asking for those demands. You know, quite often you can facilitate them to a point, or you can do as much as you can towards them. Other times it will just be a demand that has to happen. And at that point, you definitely want to make sure that you've got your contractors on side, and that you've got a big, big level of reward you can give them if it's, you know, because at the end of the day, it's normally not you that's going to physically have to make those changes or do whatever it is they need. And some good grace from whoever is there at the sort of the coal face, as it were, is going to go a long way to delivering that change.
One of the questions that came in early, and I think we've well answered it nearly at this stage, is how important supplier relationships are. And that's when you want your suppliers knowing that if you have to come to them late on the night before doors when they think they're done, and you have to ask them to do something that you know in your heart what you're asking, you know how painful it is, but you're only coming to them because you do have to ask it. And if there were avenues to avoid it, you've explored them, and now you're here asking them to do it. And I think when you have good suppliers that you work with regularly, no one wants to be doing those random last minute anythings. But people know everyone works together to get the show on the road, and no one designed it that way, but sometimes things happen, and that's where that goodwill and, you know, as you said, whether it's, you know, sharing cold drinks when you have them or sending around a few ice creams. It's amazing what some cold drinks and ice creams can do on a sunny day, you know, buy goodwill. I'm bad at this. Sorry. CDM. People are asking what CDM is. So construction design and management, I guess, a set of regulations that basically governing the safety, health and safety rules around bills for events and stuff like that. Not just for events, but it got focused. Events had a spotlight shone on it a few years ago in the UK, which is where all this discussion arises out of. So it's not the Centre for Disease Management and stuff like that that people are asking. I do apologize. I should have explained what that was before we mentioned it. Right. So that's how do we stop ourselves pulling our hair out. You mentioned a good few times the importance of inductions and briefings and stuff like that. Again, there's a software question here. Have you seen a software that works really well for inductions? And it's allied to another question, which was, in your opinion, and look, people have, as you said, people have a million ways of doing things, but as regards inductions and briefings and information ahead of time versus information delivered when people are on site, how do you see a balance working there? What way do you like to kind of get that information to people? What works for you, I guess?
I mean, there's definitely some good software out there that can deliver some really good inductions before people arrive. I think quite often it's always good if it can be easy, you know, if it's part of what somebody has to do to already book their accreditation and their catering, and they need to make sure their guys sit and go through that presentation to do the induction, and that's rolled into one thing that makes the person who has to administer that as part of the contractor, if their life is easy through that, it works really well. One clear advantage, I think, of doing it ahead of time, certainly on your really big busy builds, is that you're basically taking out a part of people's day on site to deliver that presentation or induction. So if people can sit and do that before they get to site, that accreditation process, that arriving on site, that getting your first sort of half hour, 2 hours up and running is much easier. The only slight downside I can see to those big systems is that they're only as good as the sort of management of them and making sure they do go to the right people and the right people are seeing them and reading them. And, you know, quite often there's a situation where, you know, you'll get a different guy turning up to your site to start laying your trackway because he was in the area on that Friday and had enough panels to start your entrance route or whatever it might be, but wasn't booked to be on the show, so hasn't done any induction. And that's the point where you need to just, you know, be able to quickly whip out that presentation or induction and get them to sign on to it. It doesn't need to be big and difficult. But I definitely think having a backup if you are going down that route of, you know, online inductions is useful.
Yeah, and the other thing to consider, and I've seen people hit this kind of and learn it that the hard way as such, is that there's such a thing as sending out information and their induction too far in advance too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you could send it out a month ahead of time and think you're the bee's knees and you've spent too much building it and you've sent it out now and everyone has it. Realistically, if you understand the event industry, one of two things will happen. Either it's still not going to get looked at till they're driving to your site with a truckload of gear, or they have a gap, so they fly through it and they tick the box and the system says they've done it, but they've done it a month ahead of time and they're going to be on six more shows before they get to you. So you're right, there's a balance here between, you know, and it works. I've seen different systems work much better on different events. I would suggest have a toolkit and then consider the event, consider any challenges you have, and then pick what might work for that. I mean, if it's a load of suppliers that I know have done our online stuff before and are familiar with it, I may be very quick to use the online version. If it's a load of new suppliers and it's a new show to me as well, maybe you put the time into, you know, telling everyone that they're not going to get started until an hour after they hit site because we have to run through a briefing or whatever. So I think you made the point earlier on that it, sometimes the way you approach things depends on the show, whether it should or it shouldn't, and how that show works and stuff. And I think that's a key element of it. There's no, as we regularly say, there's no one size fits all, I think.
Yeah.
But it's about having a toolkit and picking the right tools, probably.
I think as well, you can sometimes go down the road, especially with those sort of sent in advance presentations, of essentially copying and pasting the basics. Yeah. And whilst it is really important that, you know, people are aware of, you know, manual handling and those sorts of things, when they're on site, the reality is it's more important they're aware of the water or the soft ground or the overhead power cables. And so, you know, if you're worried about those things on site, then, you know, add that other briefing, make sure that guys working in those areas are briefed for that specific task.
In my experience, you're never going to not have some level of update or briefing on site, because things will have happened, or as you said, you do your thing in advance and say it's brilliant and it's a week in advance and it's plenty of time and it's timely, but then things change on site or someone's delayed. And with the best will in the world, as you said, we deal with lots of agencies and suppliers, and just because we've relayed to their head office that, look, the lads have hit a pipe this morning, everything's an hour behind, let your guys know just in case it helps them out or stops them stressing, they will be an hour delayed. Whether that actually gets the guys in the truck or the van, who knows? So they could arrive on site under pressure, not knowing there's any issue. So things change really quickly. So I think you'll always have at least that element of you have to check in at X spot, and if you need any updates, that's where you get them. So you can't have people just looking at a plan from a week ago, arriving on site, heading to where they need to do their work without checking in and getting any update. You need that facility, I think.
Definitely.
How early, there's been a few versions of how early do you involve safety in what you're planning. I think we touched on it earlier on about involving everyone as early as you reasonably can. And I say, especially, again, easy to say as the safety guy, but I say this quite regularly to clients, involving me earlier in the process doesn't necessarily mean I cost you more or it takes me more time. But if I'm asking to be involved earlier and we have that discussion, chances are we can split the time over longer and it's the same price. It could even be the less money. But it's not about, for me anyway, it's not about me trying to bill you more hours. It's about me saving you time and money, because if we spot something at version one of the site plan, it's better that we catch it there. If that takes me 20 minutes, I'd sooner do 10 sets of half an hour reviews of 10 site plans than only be sent number 8, have to bill for a day to review it, and then have to bill for further days to advise on how to fix the clusterfuck that I've seen on a plan. So again, it's not a money thing. It's a, how do we best do our job for you? And I think there's some very specific questions actually in the chat from people who have specific challenges, and it's hard to answer very specific questions. But one of the answers, which I think was a little flippant, but hit the nail on the head, is, you know, how someone asked, how much health and safety input do I need for X? And one of the answers was, as much as you can afford. And a little bit of that, in that, just whatever about the money end of it, I'd say involve health and safety eyes early and understand that there is a difference between traditional health and safety, construction health and safety eyes, and crowd safety eyes. Mm-hmm. You may have people who do both. That's legit. I know some amazing people who do both, but your event might actually need both sets of eyes, and maybe they're separate people. So just to keep that in mind, safety isn't safety. Do you know what I mean? There are specialists within it. Like I always talk about the time I was at Glastonbury and I had never encountered the fact that we had laser safety specialists and gas safety specialists. That's all they did. So anything I came across that was lasers, or I got onto Tim, and gas, I get onto someone else because they are just such specialist areas, you know?
I think that's it. And I think, you know, I think particularly with site management and builds, it's inevitably going to be cheaper, you know, no matter how much your day rate is for a safety guy, to look at that for, as you say, at half a day, or however many days you build in for that advanced period, is going to be cheaper than having to bring 20 guys back and a crane or whatever it might be, worst case scenario, to make, you know, an essential change. And therefore it's going to be cheaper. And again, I think, like you said, it's about having those relationships with the people. You know, if, you know, for instance, if we're booking safety officers or advisors for whatever gig it is, you've got an idea of how many days it is on site and then how much advance time it is. But bounce that back and forth between you, you know, oh, it's a new gig for me, I'd like to spend a bit more time looking at it. Can I have an extra day? No dramas. We'll need you 6 months before to come to a site visit with us because it's a finickety weird site that's going to be better for you to see early. All of those things will pay dividends. So as early as possible, and again, really.
Like experienced event people, I guess, sometimes I forget, in my position, particularly because we're an event management company as well, like we run events as well as just do safety on some other events. Mm-hmm. So like we're quite clued into all the pressures everyone else has. So when I see version 8 of the plan and see a problem, I do see the knock-on effects of what I'm about to explain to people is a problem. So if I have a marquee that needs another exit and they've already sold all the exhibition space, I know they've sold 2 booths that now have to go somewhere else because I need to get, like, I get it. But it doesn't stop me having to be the one who goes, we need another exit in here. I understand you've already sold that space. Here's a solution that might work for you. I always feel a whole lot better breaking bad news. Even if I don't feel I was given the detail early enough, I feel better breaking bad news if I can offer a solution as well, or a number of solutions. But sometimes it's not possible, and the safety people do have to go, that these things I can work with you on, and I can that we can work with. These things have to change. Like, and an exit is always the good example. Like a marquee or a tent or something needs another exit. If we've run figures and it needs it, it kind of needs it. There's no fudge in that. And sometimes the alternative is, right, we don't have to put in an exit, but this is the management system you'd have to put on it to control the capacity. And when you look at the number of bodies involved and multiply that by the hour, like, it's just nonsense then. And sometimes that's how you get to, all right, knock a wall, put an exit in, do whatever we need. because I'm not paying for that much yeah. extra security. So if you can have the more expensive option and go, or we could do this, like, I'll definitely take the second one. Thanks very much. And again, that comes with experience. And some clients, you know, you'd approach that way. Other clients, they'll just take it easily and you go, that needs another exit. That's, you go, fine, perfect. Yeah, make it happen, no figure chance. It out.
Yeah.
We should have involved you earlier. You know? but again, there's this thing, look, people expect that maybe the safety people are going to break their hearts, and I get it. But I think the later you bring us in, the more likely we are to be breaking your heart.
Yeah. So. And like I say, I think if you can solve those things early and you can get it nailed down early, then people's expectations haven't grown to the extent where they're absolutely adamant and set on something.
Yeah.
And you know, it's much easier to break.
Yeah. And of course, that's not to say stuff still doesn't come up on site and you know, everyone rolls at the punches and fixes things. You won't spot everything. In the planning, no matter how well we plan, we'll always, you know, you'll change things on site. But I think it's just in general involve every important voice at the table as early as possible, even if it means spreading people's involvement out over longer. And again, from a cost perspective, I know because we've done it, it can be cost neutral. It saves money the odd time, but it can cost a tiny bit more, but it's definitely worth it because there's knock-on costs. If you're looking at Mark wants to charge me an extra day, you're looking at Mark's day rate, but the consequence of not giving Mark one extra day could be that, well, your designers are going to have three extra days when they have to figure out that exit because all the knock-on effects, and you're not going to be in a position to argue with the designers at that point because you're coming going, safety says we have to do this, and they're going 100% we can do that. It's going to take 3 days. That's how much it costs. You're like, then safety caused the cost.
Safety
people. But no, look, it's, and I think you're a bit like us in that if you could click your fingers on a new project, bring the same suppliers you're comfortable with, everyone knows, people can sometimes think it's dodgy and everyone's getting backdoor deals and things and all that. And there may or may not be a bit of that. But the point is, if our reputation's on the line, yes, of course, we're going to want to involve suppliers we know are good or suppliers we know will get up from their Sunday dinner because Mark's an idiot and forgot to book an extra something.
Yeah,
and he'll go to the yard and bring it. Like, that's the type of thing you don't want to do too often, but you want those people working with you.
I think as well, you know, there's times and there's certain contractors or certain elements to a show where, you know, you know you can possibly take a risk on getting to know a new contractor because what you're asking them to do on that show is relatively straightforward. Mm. Whereas if it's another show where it's not so straightforward, you know, you're going to be feeling much more comfortable with somebody you've worked with in the past and you know how they work. Yeah.
And I do, genuinely, this has come up before, I feel bad for people, you know, when you're getting those emails going, oh, we do this, we'd love to be considered for your next event, and whether it's catering or plumbing or whatever. And it's like, it's a tough industry to break into in some respects because quite legitimately, the likes of you, if you're picking the suppliers for a client or us or whatever, of course, we want to stick with what we know and is tried and tested because it's our reputation's on the line and it doesn't make sense to risk using someone brand new on a huge function. And that's the honest answer to people going, oh, can I do your power? Can I do your power? And you go, look, you and I get on quite well. I think we might work well together, but I have to find the right opportunity to involve you and test it. I can't just take John off my biggest show and let you do the power and take that risk for my client. And those are tough conversations. Even if you think you would work well with someone, you're taking a risk when you change your suppliers or contractors. And that has to be a balanced risk. And you have to figure out, as you said, find an opportunity. Maybe there's a secondary, maybe there's a web of backup Jennies that need to go in or something that maybe you can involve. Like, you'll find something if it makes sense to. But I do feel bad for the people who feel like they're banging on that door all the time trying to get work. And they'll easily say down the pub, oh, your man Mark won't give anyone any extra work. Like, he's working with the same people all the time. Of course I am.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't think about it. It makes sense. So it's tough.
Yeah, and I feel for those guys that are, you know, trying to, you know, if it's a new company starting up or it's somebody trying to pick up some different clients, whatever it might be. But I think it's also worth people knowing, as you say, one, you know, your reputation relies on those people delivering what they say they're going to do. And that's not to say at all that those new people couldn't deliver that. But there's times and places where you feel more comfortable trying new things out.
Yeah.
And like you say, it's unlikely to be on your biggest, most high profile show that's got a lot resting on it. And we do want to find new suppliers and try new things and work different things out because it's good for us as well. But it's about when those things happen, and it's just about timing a lot of the time.
I think it needs to be the right time and opportunity. I think in industry we can all cite various examples of when, you know, big events maybe move from X supplier to Y supplier and it didn't quite work out.
They're
cautionary tales that we all kind of live by. I'm getting towards the end of questions, so I'll say what I normally say. If anyone has a burning question, now is the time to throw it in, because I'm on the last couple on the list. Someone made the point along the way, the equipment checks and stuff, are they not solely the responsibility of the contractor and whoever's delivering them into you? And again, that sparked some good chat, so there were some good perspectives on that. But from your opinion, when you talk about doing equipment checks or plant checks or anything, like, what level of checks are we talking about there from that you guys would be doing?
There's obviously a balance there. Like, from my point of view, and again, it goes back to the supplier. You know, if I'm bringing in plant, I'm going to work with somebody who I know will have done all the relevant checks they need to do before they send it out to me. You know, I'm definitely looking for that thorough examination ticket, particularly if somebody's going to be using a man basket or it's going to be lifting unusual loads or whatever it is. I'm going to want that from every supplier that's supplying that sort of stuff. But if you're on site for 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, 8 weeks at times, you need to know if, for whatever reason, that beacon's been knocked off, that mirror's not working anymore, the hydraulics are a bit loose on that one. You know, whatever happens to those bits of kit on site, you need to know those problems. You need to get a log of them ahead of them becoming an actual problem, and get them fixed. And for that reason, as a sort of fairly basic, what I like to do is have any of my guys, so any of the crew I've brought in, or any of the sort of site crew doing their own daily checks on their bit of kit. It shouldn't take more than, you know, 10-15 minutes of a morning. And you know, it's not just ticking that box, it's actually to make sure that it's in good nick. Similarly, if we're handing stuff over to, you know, the bars have got four forks for whatever reason for a week, we'll give them that opportunity to do that on a daily basis. But before we hand it to them, a bit like you'd hire out a car, we'd go around with their guys picking up that kit from us and essentially showing them that everything's working, it's all in good nick. And I think that's for two reasons. One, it's to make sure that obviously it is safe for them to be using. But two, if you set the precedent that you're very aware that that fork is, you know, has only got 400 hours on the clock and it's pretty much a brand new machine, then they know that when they bring it back that you'll expect to see it like that. And so in theory, should be driving it that bit more carefully and a bit more aware of things.
Especially a new one, you're like, be extra careful with the new one, please.
Exactly.
We'll definitely spot a large dent on that when it comes back.
That's exactly it. And then I guess other kit across the board, like you say, it should be coming from the hirer or the supplier with those checks in place. But there's nothing wrong with giving it a once over every now and again, just to make sure that it is in good nick, particularly if it's getting passed between different people using it for you know, different jobs.
Yeah. No, I think that's a good point. Like the forks, and they're a good example, and that type of plant on a big festival site, like, it just gets, like, no one wants to play. We've all played it. No one wants to play the where the hell can I get a forks from game.
Exactly.
You know, you need management on who has them, where the keys are, who can get them, who can pull rank and say, I need that for an hour right now. Thanks very much. For those panicky moments where you need to go and do something that wasn't in the schedule. And the one that the spare one is spare because it's got no fuel or it doesn't work or whatever.
Exactly that.
Okay, there's been no more burning questions coming in. So I'm going to finish up on two things. One, I want to echo one of your last points because I don't want people to miss. Again, I could be preaching to the converted here, but I don't want people to miss the importance of it. Doing the inventory at the end of a show is so important. It's pain in the ass. Everyone's tired, blah, blah, blah. It's so important because inevitably you head into that show next year or the next time you need that gear, needing, from a time perspective, you're busy, you need to have confidence that everything's in there. It's been checked. It works. We lost three of these things. I just need to buy them. We're good again. And that buys you time and headspace, and it's invaluable. I cannot explain how important that is. We learned this lesson with some emergency grab bags that we have for a very specific show. And if I can, I keep them fully intact. We don't dip into them year to year. We keep them for that show. and there's a big paper trail situation if we have to dip into them. So we definitely know to replace equipment, because some of the equipment's a little bit specialized. So definitely do those inventories. And it's I think we've all been bitten by that one.
I mean, I think to my certainly for me, I learned it the hard way, and I don't know if anyone else has magically been perfect.
That exact phrase is in the chat there. Learned that the hard way.
Exactly. And you know, maybe that's one of those lessons everyone has to learn the hard way. But
yeah, maybe it is. But we're trying to save you from that. Anyone have dates when they're doing shows? Actually, Chris, we've been doing a couple of live things just with very small audiences. We've another couple of things this weekend, but they're kind of state things. They're not really public. They'll have a few hundred people at them, but they're not public. But I think other people are starting to get into the drive-in stuff. So thankfully, I think we're seeing green shoots. It depends on where you are in the world, that may or may not be true, but there are some green shoots anyway. At the same time, I'm conscious people here from Melbourne are going into a lockdown again. So, you know, we'll get there. This will all be behind us at some stage. Definitely. So sorry, all that's left for me really is to thank you, Tom, for doing it. Again, I don't want to blow smoke up your ass, but I think the structure was really, really good. And I think it helped people, and people have made that comment. You can read through the chat if you want. People have made the comment that the structure very much helped in the learning kind of side of this. So you did really well there from my perspective and theirs.
Thank you very much.
I am, because we can, I'm going to finish this one by playing that lovely video again, because we all need to be reminded of what we do, why we love what we do, and that we will be back there doing it again, hopefully sooner rather than later. But we will be back in green fields making people smile again, if that's your thing, or back in a stadium with a crowd, or whatever your thing is. We're going to get there. It may take longer. It will take longer than we all want, because it's already taken longer than we all want. But keep the love for it. That's the only reason we all do it. It's generally not for the money. It's not for the good work-life balance. You know, not many of us have either of them. But, you know, we love doing it. And I think that it's a great video. People were saying in the chat that it had them dancing and everything earlier on. So.
Oh, good. Good.
I think we will say goodbye. I'm going to put that video on just to finish, and then I'll shut down the room after that video is played. And thank you very much. And thank you all you guys for joining us and getting involved in the chat cards.
Thanks very much. Cheers.